All right, well, I don't know how you guys want to do this. We can do it any way you want. I'm pretty easygoing. If you guys have questions while I'm talking about the book, feel free to ask. But my idea here is just to kind of go through the project, explain what it is, and let you see a little bit of it here. And did we pass one around yet? Oh,
yeah, right here.
Oh, here. So I've got one here. I'll start with, if you guys just want to like check it out while I listen to it. And then after I'm done talking about it, we'll just have a bunch of questions, and maybe people can come up here and dance and stuff like that. So, this project, this is my third book. The first book I did, I didn't want to do, and I was really, really embarrassed because I was pretty early on in my career still, but I was teaching for an art school. I still am teaching for an art school, an online school called Schoolism. And the school was like, oh, you gotta make a book. You gotta do a book. You know, everyone's got books out. And I always kind of figured, well, maybe when I'm like an old man and if I become successful, someone can make a book about me. That was kind of my idea. And so my first book, I was very embarrassed. And also, I'm known for caricature art, but I hate the word caricature because I really feel it puts artists in a box. I do way more than caricature. Caricature is only a tool. And I actually have been calling myself lately an expression impressionist. Bada bing, bada boom. So it's on my business card, I can't steal it. But the funny thing was the first book, I just said, okay, I want to do it. It's going to show my caricature work in the book. It's going to show whatever. But I don't want the word caricature in the book anywhere. So the title of the book was called Caricature, The Art of Jason Seiler. And I was like, what in the world? So, the book, it was cool to have a book out, but it was, you know, it was my first book and whatever. It was, I didn't have that much to do with it. The second book I did, it was in 2009, and it was pretty much just a book that was a bunch of my, you know, just private pieces, and not really any, maybe a couple commission pieces, and then a tutorial in the back. And I basically did that book for fans, because I was starting to build a fan base, and people were asking for a book, and so I did that one. But it was a terrible experience in one way, because I did everything myself. You know, I laid out the whole book. I had to pay for everything myself, and then I had like thousands of books in my house, and I had to do all the shipping. I had to do all the packing. And I was like, I am never doing that again. It's not happening again. So here's my third book, and this one is big. It's like 300 pages almost. And it's been a while now since the last book, and I've been very, very fortunate to have done a lot more work, work for a lot more clients, a lot more experiences, and also come up with a lot more connections, like with pretty much every magazine out there and a lot of different companies. And I was, this company that did this book, They were after me for a while, asking me to do a book, and I, before I get into that, they had put out several books of artists before I did this book, that wanted me to write forwards or something for their book, and this happened over and over and over again, and finally I told them, like, when are you gonna make my book? Like, I keep getting, you know, writing forwards for everybody for their book, but when am I going to have my book? So then we started talking together about, hey, what should this book be about? And and by the way, one of my reasons for doing it, or one of my
thank you.
Oh, sorry, confusing. What's happening?
Leave the lights on, please.
Okay. One of my deals for this was that I'm not doing the shipping. I am not doing any of that stuff, and so thankfully, I don't have anything to do with that. So that's pretty awesome. So, but the thing about this book, I didn't want to do another portfolio book. Like, hey, here's my work. Okay, this is the, you know, just page after page of, there's so many books like that, and for me, it's really, really boring. I mean, unless it's an artist that blows my mind, and I'm like a huge, huge, like, you know, I don't know, I'm very, very picky about that. There's only a couple artists, like I've got a Jenny Seville book. I don't know if you guys know who she is, but she's one of my favorite painters. She's insanely awesome. I have a book of hers of just her paintings. It's really a great book. But I didn't want to do that again. I already did that. I want to do something else. So this book is basically, I wanted to do something that is based off of reality. No, trying to be cool. Just the raw truth of what it's like to be an artist and an illustrator in the real world. What is it like to work for magazines? What is it like to work with art directors and editors? What about taxes and marketing? And all these different things I wanted to try to do. I wanted to tell the real story. Also, the back of the book, I've got a lot of awesome guest artists that are all fine artists. And it's the kind of art and artists that inspire me personally. So the back of the book has that, and it's got the perspective of fine art and what it's like to be in the fine art world with galleries and all that kind of stuff. And actually, one of the artists is here, Grigor. He's one of my best friends, and he's in the back of the book, so you can check his stuff out. And so really what I wanted to do with this book is I wanted to show, the book starts off, I'll go through it real quick here, but the book starts off with my childhood and explains how I got where I am today, like what, you know, why I got started in art, what I was interested in, what got me into doing illustration work and all that kind of stuff. And then I break apart the book into sections of different magazines I've worked for, and then I have the art director from the magazines have an interview in the back, which is really, really cool. It was awesome to get the support from magazines like Time and Rolling Stone and The New Yorker and all these different people. It was pretty cool. And then there's also tutorials in the book. There's QR codes where you can watch all the interviews, interviews with me, interviews with Grigor, interviews with all the other artists, art directors. There's a 5-hour painting demo that I did of Johnny Cash. From beginning to end, no editing at all. I didn't want to end. I mean, if you get bored, just skip ahead. But I thought it'd be really cool to just have the raw, this is the real deal. Even little mistakes, everything, it's all there. And then my first DVD that I did in 2009 on sketching comes with the book as well. So I wanted to create a book that I wish I would have had when I was doing what you guys are doing now, or just like, you know, something that's about the industry and what it's really like, the struggles, the passion, the joys, the humor, everything. So hopefully you guys will enjoy this. So I'm gonna flip through. This works. So it's a recent painting I did for the New York Observer. Something cool too, like this is a painting I did of the past art director of Rolling Stone, and I was told that I was one of his favorite illustrators, which was really, really cool. So when he retired to work, he started working at Entertainment Weekly after that. They secretly commissioned me to do a painting of him. You can see it there again, to look like it's from the Rolling Stone music review section, and they wanted him to look really cool and whatever. So like, I had to. He's kind of a well, he's not really a rock star. He's an art director, so it was a challenge to make him look cool. No, he is a pretty cool guy. He's really cool. But I was really, really honored because he agreed to write the foreword for the book. So that was really, really cool. And when I read what he wrote, it was really cool too, because, you know, as an artist, you don't really, you develop a relationship with art directors, but it's not like your best friends or anything. And he talks about what it was like for him when I first walked into the Rolling Stone offices. What he thought of me. Like, he thought I was like some hipster bartender from Brooklyn or something like that. And he was like, he's like, who's this guy? And he wasn't expecting to see the work that I did and stuff. So it meant a lot that he wrote this. And here's a picture of him. And you can see that my painting, they made it look like like it's in the magazine, you know, they presented it that way. And then my friend Victor, who does a lot for Rolling Stone, he did the cover, like a fake Rolling Stone cover of them, so it's pretty cool. So let's flip, like a lot of this, the stuff in the beginning are just like some more recent finished paintings. This is a recent painting I did for a restaurant chain. The guy, he was a World War II vet, and then he owns all these restaurants, Freddy's Frozen Custard, and I have a real soft spot for World War II and for vets. And I was asked to do this, and I just thought he was the coolest guy, and I heard he's got an amazing story. So this was going to be these nice G-clay prints that are going to, I think, hang in all of the restaurants, which is kind of cool. And this is my buddy Sturgill Simpson. I just did this, and it's a record cover, my first record cover ever painted. I don't have the actual cover in my book because I don't have permission to use the actual printed cover. But it's pretty awesome, pretty excited. If you don't know who Sturgill Simpson is, you should look him up because he's like tearing up the charts right now, and I'm pretty proud of him. It's pretty awesome. That's me before I cut the mustache off. It's me when I was a little kid. So the beginning of the book talks about the importance of my family, my grandpa, and different things that led me to getting to art. My dad's an artist. I show a bunch of my childhood drawings. These are like when I was like 10 years old, sketches from a sketchbook. And like that wood, that I'm obsessed with sharks. And when I was a kid, I have a pictures, I don't know if you can see it. It's hard to see in the bottom, but the bottom right is all these pages with sharks. When I was a kid, I made a book that had like 350 different sharks in it. And like I wrote in like Latin, their name, drew their, I was just pretty nerdy. Put their shark tooth, and I used to be able to look at a shark tooth and say, oh, that's a lemon shark, that's a, you know, whatever, goblin shark, whatever. So, but that's a wood carving of a great white that I did when I was 12 years old. Carved it out of basswood and then painted it with acrylics. So I was a little bit insane when it came to sharks. And those are some of my first drawings, like first realistically rendered drawings. When I was trying to get into character work, I wanted to try to do caricature work, but really, you know, exaggerate a lot and then try to render as realistic as possible, but I didn't know how to paint. So this is before I could paint, so I just did a lot of drawings. Some of my first acrylics. And you can see like the QR codes, if you scan those codes, you get to watch interviews and different things like that. I did this painting here, by the way, when I was going to school here. When I was going to school here, I worked on a film called The Breakup with Vince Vaughn. And I got to go hang out with him and everything. I did artwork for the movie, but the artwork I did was kind of lame, but it's what they wanted. And I felt like I want to show him what I can really do. So in one of my classes, I think it was a fundamentals class, I did this acrylic and then I gave it to Vince Vaughn as a gift. But he didn't seem very amused. So that's an early watercolor. All this early stuff is basically me trying to discover my style and what, you know, do I want to primarily work in watercolor or acrylic or you know, oil? And so a lot of the beginning stages as an illustrator for me was, you know, just developing and pushing and pushing. I think ultimately all those things made me the artist I am now because I can basically do any medium I want. Like having that knowledge is good, but it's very important to have a style that is immediate, like, oh, that's Seiler, or that's, you know, whoever it is. So early on, in the book, I wanted to show those different pieces. That's the first real painting I ever did, the night that my daughter Isabel was born. I won't get into the story, you can read in the book, but basically I had a panic attack and when she was about to be born, and I realized I don't know how to paint, I'm not going to be able to take care of my family, I'm a joke, I'm a terrible artist, and I'm not going to be able to take care of them unless I learn how to paint. And so I did my first painting, and then I've been painting ever since. So, and the Fitty, that was my second painting. So, and then Arnold, that was my first digital painting I did, Arnold. These are some old, these are just some sketches. So a lot of sketches and studies. These are all studies and sketches. And so in between the articles, I have like pages of final work sketches and stuff like that. That's, I call that Big Mike or Dirty Santa. This is a billboard I did for the Summer Olympics, in 2012 Summer Olympics. It's pretty awesome because it was, I painted it digitally. It's probably about that big, but then, like, and it was on a billboard. It's crazy, pretty cool. I don't know how good it looked up close when you see it on a billboard, but. I actually did this painting while I was going to school here too. This was one of my first covers for a magazine. Well, I had done a few covers for magazines by this point, but I was trying to push myself and push myself into a different category. I wanted to be professional, and I was doing a lot of magazines just to get the work, but I was barely getting paid, and it was pretty terrible. But I wanted to get past that. So every single time I got an opportunity to do a magazine cover or an illustration, I just took it to the next level. I tried to bite off more than I could chew, basically. So this one is all acrylic, and like on an illustration board, and you know, there's a lot of things that are terrible about it, but at the same time, to me, it's an important piece because I still didn't really know how to paint when I did this. Like, not really. While I'm doing this, if you could see it up close, I didn't understand painting. You paint brush strokes and values, and you know, you sculpt. I went from doing color pencil and pencil stuff where I was cross-hatching all the time. So when I started painting with acrylics, it's cross-hatching. So that entire thing is cross-hatching with acrylics. It's really, really tedious and stupid because you could do it so much faster with actual brushworks, you know? So it was a very, very important piece for me because I learned a lot doing it. And here's some more really, really old covers and illustrations for magazines. The one on the far right actually did when I was here and I was in Matt Kennedy's class. I can't remember her name, the actress. Bette Midler, yeah. I don't know why they wanted her to look like that, but. So this is like one of my first covers where this cover basically changed everything for me because before I had done this, I hadn't, I kind of had this weird idea that, you know, a real artist doesn't really use very much reference. You know, a real artist just draws and paints, you know, and creates from their head and whatever else. But then I love Norman Rockwell. I started really getting into Rockwell, started reading his process, and I was like, oh, he gets models. He sets models up, he lights them, he clothes them the way he wants. He gets props. I once heard a story about him. He needed to paint a duck, and so the duck wouldn't sit still, so he nailed the duck to a piece of wood in front of him so he could paint him, you know? But it's okay, the web's like fingernail. You know, don't get hard on the dude. You know, this is a long time ago. This was before digital cameras and stuff. He had to paint that shit, you know? So anyway, I'm like, okay. I had a big attitude change when I did this. Because I also realized before I was like, oh, I'm only getting $100 for the cover. And I did a good job as best I could, but I didn't have a good attitude about it. So I did this cover. I got a model. I got props. I lit them the way I wanted. I did a bunch of studies and sketches and ideas. And I really took my time. And I didn't care that I was only getting like $150 or $200 for that cover. All I wanted was, okay, I'm gonna do something that that should be on a Mad Magazine cover, and I should be getting $3,000 or whatever. So in my mind, I'm getting $3,000 for this, and this is for Mad Magazine. And that attitude changed everything for me. Because after I did this piece, I never worked for those magazines ever again. Like, I think actually the next job I did was for Time Magazine after that cover. And it was like a small thing for Time 100 online. And it was a bunch of celebrities that I had like 4 or 5 days to paint 5 people super realistically. And That was another challenge because I never had done that before. I'm going to go through a little bit quicker now just to show you some of the sections. This is a recent thing. I use myself as reference for the zombie, but the zombie represents a political law that that basically our government is not going to be able to stop. I mean, that's what they were writing about. Like, it's basically like a zombie and it's going to spread. So the cover was supposed to be like you know, Walking Dead, like badass looking zombie, and they said just make it as gross as possible and have fun with it. And I had to like actually edit that because it was worse than this. But it was a lot of fun to do. And so I have show some of the process here. Originally, the zombie had handlebar mustache, partially because I did, but also because I thought that was so cool that the only thing not dying is this mustache. It lives. The mustache lives. And it's just like, no matter how gross he is, it's a perfect, beautiful mustache. And they didn't see why that was funny. And so, in one way, I'm kind of happy that I got rid of it, just because I got to rip apart his face, and you can see, and now it looks a little bit grosser, but I still kind of miss the mustache. So, so these are studies just showing references. It's like a behind the scenes of what happened when I was working on it, sketch phases. Here's the final, Obama kicking his ass. Actually, I've painted Obama probably 60 or 70 times now, and I'm pretty sure he doesn't like me. And so I think it's appropriate that Obama's hacking into my neck. Oh, and there, you see like the grub? There was like a lot more grubs flying around, and they're all over, and they're like, so gross, don't have, no, I'm like, you said, make it gross. This is my favorite one of Nancy Pelosi. I've drawn her a lot too. So it's like these two people, I have painted them so many times. I know they're like, oh, goddamn Seiler. And so, like, this is for you, Nancy Pelosi and Obama, hacking me up. But I love this one so much just because the zombie, even though there's, you know, they don't have much expression, it's like you can feel that this sucks for him. So these are some reference shots. And the last one is Vayner. It's hard to see, but he's got a little tear coming out of his eye. Like, I don't think he wants to kill the zombie. So, Kanye. That was a fun one to paint. He's a little bit of a cokehead. So, this is another one of my favorites. That's just a guy I know, and I wanted to paint him, so he let me pose him how I wanted, and I don't know if he's about to be peed on, or we'll see. My dad is an awesome artist, and he did a little tutorial in the book, which is really cool, on plein air painting and color palettes. So a lot of sketches and studies and stuff. So this is the Johnny Cash thing I was telling you about. Like, it goes through the whole video. You can scan the code and watch the whole thing. Donald Trump on fire. So that's a painting of, I don't know if you guys know what Hot Dog's hot dog place is, but that's characters are sort of made up of characters that spend a lot of time there, and I just wanted to do, this is the kind of style I like to paint. This is more of my natural style, I guess. George. That's an acrylic of George. Again, that's all cross-hatching with acrylic before I understood painting. So this is going to go through the weekly standard section. I'm going to go through kind of quick. Spot illustrations, lots of covers. That's a recent cover I did. For the weekly standard, I usually have 2 days tops to do anything. So it's got to be really, really, really fast. That's at Hillary Clinton, by the way, I was talking about. So all these deadlines are 2 days. This was a trial cover for a different magazine. I talk about how they wanted to see what I could do, and I had never done something with that many people in a scene in less than 2 days before, and so I thought I did okay, but it didn't work out, and it was like such a bummer for me personally, but because of that, it taught me a lot, and I became faster, and you know, it helped me work on things. But it was quite a shocker when I finally got the opportunity, because the deal was I would be doing a cover for them every other week, and I was really excited for that opportunity. But then they're like, "Oh yeah, you have 2 days." I'm like, "Oh, no." So then after that, I just kept working and working and working, and then I finally got a weekly standard cover, which is what I really wanted to do, because all the artists that I really looked up to at the time had done several covers for the Weekly Standard, and I kind of felt like, if I do a cover for them, I'm going to be one of them. I'm one of the guys, you know? And I was so excited to see my artwork with that logo. It was just something kind of cool to look forward to. But this is my first cover for them. I think I've done maybe, I don't know, 15 covers. I don't know how many. I've done about 80 paintings for them, I think. 70, 80, I don't know. That's a recent cover for them. And again, like 2 days basically. And this one was supposed to be in color, but then they wanted it to be like this Mexican Revolution type thing, and they really wanted to make the red tape a big deal. And I came up with the idea, let's make it look like those old revolutionary photos, but just make the tape in color, and that way I don't have to paint it in color, and I can get it done in 2 days. So I do a lot of Obamas. That's one of my favorites. I actually use myself as reference for the donkey. And the girl is the art director's daughter. She really wanted to be on the cover and wanted me to paint her. So I thought that was kind of cool. And so he sent pictures of her posed for me. And then she got like a nice print afterwards of it. This is a cover that got me in a lot of trouble. I won't get too much into it, but I think it's a pretty self-explanatory cover. If you threaten this country and you actually shoot a missile at them, you're going to die. That's basically what it's saying. But I got like a lot of death threats actually from this cover. And I got things sent to me in the mail from Iran and Iraq, packages that I had to have the FBI come and take. And the only time I found out what it was mixed nuts and peanuts and stuff. So I think they're trying to kill me. But a lot of people from the Middle East also wrote me and loved that cover too. So it wasn't just, but it was scary getting, you know, that was scary. I use myself for reference a lot. This is me as Uncle Sam. And that's me as Obama, actually. I have pictures of me going like, oh, you know. So I basically find pictures of him that are, you know, as close as I can, it's the kind of angle I want. And then I try to create the expression that I need. And that's me too, but I can't think of her name. Well, it's her, but that's based off of me. I'll tell you a really quick funny story about that one on the bottom right. It's one of the first times I did Obama and McCain. It's when they were running together or against each other. And everyone was super sensitive because Obama is black. Everyone's like so scared. And so, this is the original version. The edited version that actually was in print, I didn't put in my book because I don't want to edit what I did. So this is the real version. But when I handed it in, they were like, do you think you could make his lips smaller? You know, because you know, just don't make his lips so big. I'm like, really? I was like, I have big friggin' lips myself. You know, like, so what I did is I actually made McCain's lips bigger than Obama's. I made Obama's lips a little smaller and then made McCain's lips really big as a joke, and they never noticed. But that's why McCain's lips look pretty big there. But anyway, the funny thing is now no one cares how you draw Obama. Now it's just like, oh, just draw him like whatever you want. Like that. That's one of my favorite ones. You can see his vertebrae and his neck, it looks like steps. So there's a bunch of inside stuff for the Weekly Standard. That's one of my favorite portraits too, because I don't hardly ever get a chance to paint women. It's mostly men that I get hired to paint. So it's great to have variety in your portfolio, but also it's just, she's so beautiful. Like, it was so much fun to paint that. It's the Steve Jobs. This was just after, like a day after he passed away, I was asked to paint him for the cover of Adweek. So it's kind of weird painting him knowing he just passed away. And they asked me to make him look better because the references of him didn't look good. He looked super sunken in, so I had to kind of fill him up just a little bit. So, by the way, the end here, I missed all this back here is an interview with the art director of Weekly Standard. So the first part of it is my story about the Weekly Standard, what it was like. The end of it is the art director talking about it. Not about me, but about, you know, like, what do you do to get into magazine work? How do you do this? It's that kind of stuff. Der Spiegel, this is like an interview with the art director for Der Spiegel. This is artwork that I did for Der Spiegel. That was commissioned by them when he, actually about 6 months before he passed away, for his obituary cover. So it's kind of weird paying someone for that reason. She kind of looks like Newt Gingrich, doesn't she? She's not having an orgasm. She's asleep on a train. But that's a friend of mine's wife, and I asked him, this was for the Major League Baseball World Series program. I did a few paintings for him. And so this is a baseball guy, baseball player from the Jays who loves New York, and he loves to ride in the trains in New York. It's something he likes to do. So I did a little illustration of him riding the train. And I had my friend, his wife, pose for me, because I wanted a girl to look like she's asleep. And so she never saw this until it came out, and she was like, oh my God! How could you do that to me? She would never let me draw her again. But, and there's me on the other side of him, like, listening to my music. So, Jagger. So this section is the Rolling Stone section. So same thing with Rolling Stone. When I work for Rolling Stone, I have never had more than 2 days to do a painting for Rolling Stone. It's ridiculous. It's very, very stressful. But I also kind of like it because Rolling Stone's also one of the only magazines I've ever worked for that they basically just say, hey, be an artist, have fun. As long as it looks like them and it looks cool, that's all, you know. And so basically I just feel like Rolling Stone has helped me to grow and help my style to try different things, to go different areas and do things that I never normally would do because they just say, have fun. So sometimes I just pick random palettes that I've never used before or just try different textures or sometimes, like someone's arm is left sketchy, and I haven't gotten to it yet, but I realize that looks cool. It's done, and so you know, so it's just like it's allowed me to experiment, and then I send it to them, and they're totally into it. This one of what's his name, Rick Ross. This was the only one I had from that was 1 day deadline. So they called me on Thursday night, and it was due at the end of the day Friday. So I got up, did my sketch in the morning. And then I had till 6 o'clock at night to finish it. So it's crazy. This is my buddy Corey Chisel. He's a pretty awesome musician. And this was a watercolor that I did as a test to try to show Rolling Stone like early on, like, hey, I want to work for you guys. This is something I could do. I think this would be cool in your magazine. And so that I did a lot of that kind of stuff for magazines. Like I try to do something that I think they would like and I send it and see what happens. So this was my first painting for Rolling Stone, Lil Wayne. And I heard of Lil Wayne before, but I never heard his music, so I bought his records. And so for 2 days straight, I was just like, heh, heh. The whole time. I can't say anything else he says because it's just not good to say. He says a lot of C words and F words. And anyway, I love that guy. So that's the sketch of it. So I did the sketch. I actually kind of like the sketch almost as much as the final. But when I got that call, like I went to Rolling Stone and I went in and I had a meeting with them and they, you know, it was a really good meeting and they said, hey, we're going to be working together really soon. Part of me is like, yeah, right. We'll see when it happens because, you know, you're told that all the time. And when I left, I was excited. You know, this is cool. But I didn't think it was going to happen for a while. 2 days later, next morning, I got the Lil Wayne piece. And literally when I got off the phone, I was just jumping up and down. I'm like, yeah, it was awesome. So This is showing process of my Gary Clark painting, and then I got to hang out, because of the painting, Gary Clark contacted me, and I got to go hang out with him, which was really cool, and watch him play, and his agent bought a couple prints for me, so that was pretty awesome. There's pictures of me referencing for the Black Keys painting I did for them. That's the final Gary Clark. So this one, I figured he plays the blues, so I just did like all kinds of tones of blues and just, you know, try to make it look cool. Just make it look cool. This is Elton and Leon Russell, I think. Yeah. And yeah, the Leon Russell one and the Elton one, that was my second painting, and it was really stressful because the back of this, again, the art director for Rolling Stone has a whole interview, which is really, really a good read. So it tells you a lot. If you're interested in getting work for these magazines, it tells you like what they're looking for. There was no pressure, but the Elton John thing, they said, hey, by the way, the owner of Rolling Stone is like best friends with Elton John. Don't make fun of him. They were like nervous because I was known for the character work and I've done a few portraits for them, but they're like still like, just don't do any of that caricature stuff. If he doesn't like you, you'll never work for Rolling Stone again. I was like, oh, that's no pressure at all. Okay. Kanye. That's the Black Keys piece. His interview is really long. It's crazy. My phone's ringing. So, okay, I'm going to just fly through this real quick now to the end so we can do some questions, but this same thing, section on the New York Observer, shows all the different work I've done for the New York Observer. And again, interview with the art director for the New York Observer. See, Obama just is like, what's up, man? Why? I didn't like me. You scan this code in the book and you get to watch my first DVD, which is pretty, I think it's cool that they, I mean, you guys are probably more used to the QR thing. I'm really bad with technology. When we first started laying the book out, I was like, what are all those weird boxes you're putting everywhere? I had no idea what it was. But it's cool, you can scan it. I tried it on my phone, it works. You can watch videos, it's really crazy. We're in the future, folks. This is one of my favorites that I've done recently. And same thing with the New York Observer. They've been having me do a lot of portraits lately. Normally I did caricature, but now I've been doing portraits. And she says, just do something cool, you know, just make it look cool. So I'm like, all right, well, it's more, I get to just be me. A lot of magazines, they tell you how to do things from, you know, for the most part. I actually had to edit this one. He was way fatter in my original. This is for the Wall Street Journal. About kids that still live at home with their parents when they're in their 30s. So there's a record shop. This was for the New Yorker, and this is like this author, really awesome author, Alan Gerganis, and they did a story about him, and then I did the painting, and then he contacted me after, which was really cool and unexpected. And we've been kind of keeping in touch. He bought a print of it, and then he wrote a nice quote for the book, which was really cool. That's always cool when there's perks like that, because you know, you never expect anything like that to happen, so it's kind of cool. I'm represented by Richard Solomon in New York, and so this is an interview with him. So if you want to know what art reps want and looking for, there's an interview there. This is a watercolor that I did. This is the section on time. It talks about my experience with doing the Person of the Year cover. And the first painting I did for them. And then I talked about the behind the scenes, how I do it, process of step by step. And then 2 days later, after I got done finishing, I walked to Jewel and it's there at the store. It's like crazy. It's like, what? It's like, it was really weird. So that's literally a picture of me, like, I finished painting it 2 days before, and I'm holding it. I'm just like, this is so weird. So it was cool, man. It was a pretty cool experience. I love painting musicians. And especially when they have really big mouths and really big other things. Oh, and Jesse Jackson, if you're wondering, I think that I used to have a pug. And I was kind of influenced by that a little bit. So, Johnny Depp. He's afraid of clowns because that John Wayne Gacy or whatever that clown killer dude, he did paintings when he was in prison, and Johnny Depp, I guess, bought one of his paintings because he just thought, this is kind of cool, buying a painting from a serial killer. And then it haunted him, and then from there on, he's been afraid of clowns. So I decided to do a painting. And you guys know who Anthony Kosar is? He's a good friend of mine. So this is sort of a tribute, in a way, to Anthony, because I posed as the clown, and then I he let me borrow his mask, and I took all these pictures of this clown mask that he made, and then I kind of morphed it into my face. Like, so it's like a living, real version of his mask. So it's kind of cool. And Johnny's not happy about it. So here's the section. This is Grieger's section, the back of the book. It's got interviews with artists. Grieger actually did a drawing tutorial as well, so it's pretty cool. Like I said, the back of the book is basically like interviews and whatever with fine artists, so that you get a different perspective. So the first part of the book is illustration mostly, and then the back, fine art. So here's his tutorial. Wish you guys could see this stuff bigger. So this is Henrik Alderlane. So I'm just gonna go through these quick so we can do questions. So I wanna show you all the guest artists. William Ray, who's an amazing, he used to work for MAD. He used to do those really detailed paintings of Ren and Stimpy, you know, when they do the close-ups. Okay, he's all badass in the studio. He's like a gangster. My friend Tyler Jacobson, he's an awesome fantasy artist. He's does some pretty cool stuff. Cesar Santos. Jeremy Geddes, I got the pleasure to hang out with him in Australia, and he's like the coolest guy in the world. But his paintings are just insane. Just awesome. I'm sure you've seen some of his stuff before, but this one reminds me of that movie Inception. I don't know if you've seen that, but it's just crazy. Aaliyah Chapin, she's just awesome, awesome artist. Sean Barber, he's known for doing mostly tattoo-type paintings. So there's a lot of information in the book. I'm pretty stoked about it. Sean Cheatham, another awesome artist from LA. He's also an instructor, too, and he's just one of the coolest guys. That little drawing there is really cool. It's like I think it's pastel or something, but it's like really small. Robin Ely, another friend of mine, who's... his oil paintings are just crazy. Like I love the concept behind his stuff, and just how, I mean, they're crazy looking. If you see them up close, it's just unreal. David Kassan. And Justin Kaufman. This guy does a lot of work out in California for, what is it called? Anyway, he does a lot of, works for a big company. They're like an art company. I can't think of what it's called right now. Anyway, but it's pretty awesome. He does amazing stuff. And then last but not least, Sterling Hundley. I love his work. It's very different from the rest of the artists in the group, but, really, really cool. So, anyway, that's, there you go, there's the last image on there. Cheers. So, anyway, that's the book, and I think I went through pretty much the whole thing. So, but any questions or anything, just let me know and we'll, yeah.
Did you go to New York at all, or did you do this out from the Midwest, out here?
What do you mean, did I go to New York? Did I go to New York to, like, get started with, like, yeah. Did I move there?
Yeah.
No.
No?
No. I'm known, I guess, as a New York artist, like a lot of people think I am, but that's because my agent's in New York.
Okay.
I went to New York with a buddy of mine, Tom Fluharty, who's another, does the same kind of stuff, basically. A lot of illustration work. He invited me to go to New York with him, and he introduced me to his rep at the time. And she signed me, and I was with her for a few years, and then I ended up moving on to a different rep after that. But I go there all the time to meet people, and you know, that's actually the best way. Don't send postcards, it doesn't work. It's a waste of money, it doesn't work. I've been in Mad Magazine, the New York Observer, and the New York Times, and probably a different one, but those three places, I have been there when postcards come in and they just throw them. They don't even look at them. So I stopped sending postcards after I saw that. And they never worked anyway. I never got anything from postcards. But anytime I've gone to New York and I've made an appointment, I walk in with my portfolio. Now, the most professional way, I think, is to have like an iPad or a tablet where you can present it, you can zoom in, you can show them, like, you know, here's my sketches, here's my this. That's what I did the last few times. But at first I came in with a big book with just all my, like, my work. And that's kind of clumsy and hard, you know, to do. But yeah, every time I've gone there in person, I usually come out with a job, almost every time. And I think it's the impact of meeting someone in person. They see how confident you are. They see the quality of your work. It's harder at first because, you know, it's a catch-22. It's like, how do you expect us to publish you if you've never been published before? You know, but you're like, well, how? I need the chance to do it. You know, so it's kind of like a, you know, it's a very slow process. And that's why early on I started by doing really terrible jobs. Like I actually went to Borders when there was a Borders, and just went through and I found basically magazines that I've never seen before, and I flipped through them like, oh, they use illustration, okay, and I contacted those magazines and almost all of them gave me work, but they didn't pay me like hardly anything at all. Like, in fact, some of them never paid me, and they still owe me money. doing that is going to help get you, you know, if you can get your work published somewhere and do it, have a few pieces published in your portfolio, that's going to help you. You're going to have a better shot, you know, after that. So, yeah.
How do you transition from actual physical painting to digital painting?
Very carefully. I'm still transitioning. I mean, I do way more digital painting than I do traditional now, which kind of bums me out because I'd rather be doing like oil or watercolor. Those are like my favorite things to work on. And I'm trying to actually get myself to a point where I won't have to take as much work on anymore and I can focus on my traditional work. But the way I transitioned was, it was so stressful trying to get these deadlines traditionally. And so I basically just, I went to a Best Buy and I got like this little teeny tablet for like, you know, $100 or whatever. It was really, really terrible tablet. My friend Joe Bloom told me, you gotta start doing digital work. He's like, trust me, it's awesome. And I was just like, I didn't like digital work. And to this day, there's not very much digital work that I like. I was afraid I was gonna lose the integrity of my own style and my own work. So I didn't know, I was afraid to do it. And I just thought, well, it's like starting all over again, like I'm gonna have to learn this. But actually, I caught on pretty quickly. But the thing is, and I did my first painting for a magazine like the week I got it. And, you know, basically after that, I decided, whoa, I painted that in like half the time. And I'm able to paint it even tighter because I can paint faster. And that's what I want. I want like high quality work in my magazine work. Could I do it in oils? Yeah, but it would take me forever. Because when I work in oils, I'm a slowpoke. I do the blocking really, really fast, but once I start getting into it, I'm just slow at it, you know? I like to take my time. The digital stuff, I can just get in there and build. But it's taken me years to develop a look and a style that I feel happy with. Like the first like few years of it, I still was just like, oh, it's too smooth, it's too this and that. And so after years, I started developing my own techniques, my own brushes, my own ways of painting so that it feels how I work traditionally. And then when I work traditionally or digitally, I work in the same manner that I would traditionally. Like I a lot of times I do like an underpainting because I want the bottom color to pop through. I hardly use layers. Only every once in a while when it's usually sometimes a job they want you to use layers for certain things. So I don't know, I feel like I'm still figuring that out because ultimately my goal with the work is I want you to look at it and not really know how it was done. You know? I hate it when people they look at digital art like the worst thing is when people say, now is that a painting or is that digital? You know, like is that a painting or is that digital? Like it's what do you mean? It's a painting. Oh, but you did it digitally. Yeah, but it's still a painting. Like I still had to draw it and paint it, mix the colors and you know, my style, everything else, it's a painting. But it drives me nuts because like people have said, oh, the definition of paint is like with wet medium and this and that. I was like, yeah, that was like written like hundreds and hundreds of years before digital came out, you know? The definition has changed. But I think it's still really important that you work traditionally and digital if you're gonna, you know, because it's gonna strengthen your digital work if you work traditionally. I guarantee it will. Yeah.
Do you use more than one program to get your digital stuff done, or just one?
Sometimes I'll sketch in different programs like Sketchbook Pro. He got me Manga Studios, which is really fun to sketch in. But I usually just use Photoshop. I don't really like Painter very much because I don't like that they make brushes are supposed to mimic these traditional mediums. Because they look cheesy. They don't look natural at all. It looks digital. And I don't want my stuff to look digital. But with Photoshop, I can control the brushes my way and use my own textures and things to make it work. I haven't used Painter in a while. I've heard it's gotten better. But the other thing was there's too many buttons and switches it just drove me crazy. And so I like to keep it really simple. I just use paintbrush tool and I draw and I paint. Try to keep it real simple. That's just me. I have friends that use Painter that do awesome stuff, so we didn't work out, me and Painter. We didn't have a second date, basically. So, yeah.
So how did you find your agent and how important was that in terms of your success or you getting jobs?
I don't really know, to be honest. Like, I know how he found me. I was at the Society of Illustrators show in New York, and I knew of him. I've heard of him. I knew of all the artists that he represented, and so I knew who he was. And I had just ended my it felt like a marriage with my other rep. Wasn't a happy breakup. He offered to take me on, and so I started working with him, but. It's a tricky thing. I mean, in some ways, he's helped me get into doors of places like Rolling Stone. Like when I was in New York, he set up all these meetings for me. I asked him. That's the cool thing too, is they take care of all the paperwork and all that kind of stuff, which I hate doing. I hate talking to people in doing that. So I just want to draw. So that part's really cool because they take care of that. When I was in New York, he set up places for me to meet, and all I wanted to meet was Rolling Stone. That was it. But it didn't work out. And I was bummed, because I came all the way there. That's the only client I cared about. That's the only client I wanted to work for. And then I went to Major League Baseball, and I walked out with three paintings, and he was like, "Well, that's awesome. Who do you want me to call?" I'm like, "Rolling Stone. Call Rolling Stone again. Call him again." So he called him again, and they saw me, and then that's how I got in. Now, could I have probably done that myself if I was persistent enough and annoying enough? Yeah, probably, but I don't want to do that. So that's what an agent's good for, is that kind of stuff. But it's hard for me to tell now because most of the work, I'm fairly good at marketing myself. And so most the work that I get, it's just on my own. Most of it, I think. I mean, every once in a while I get something through him. So it just depends. And, you know, but sometimes, and that's a good thing too, is a good agent can negotiate and get a better deal for a job. Like, you know, and like a lot of times I get called and they want me to do, you know, a spot illustration, which in my mind, even though it's only going to be this big, it's the same amount of work if I'm doing a cover for something. It doesn't matter to me. I'm still doing a painting. It doesn't matter if you're printing it this small. So I don't think I should be paid this small little amount, even because it's there. So I'm not going to do these things, and he'll go back and forth, and he'll try to talk me into doing it. And, you know, if they're really prestigious, I'm like, I don't really care. I want to get paid for my art, you know? And then he'll go back to them and say, well, he doesn't want to do it because he doesn't feel like it's the right amount. And can we get more? And so then he'll try to push for more. And sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. So it's just one of those things where, you know, it's as you grow up, as you develop with your work, you start to learn how to balance, you know, things like art directors, editors, agent, you know, how much do you need to make per piece and that kind of thing. So an agent can be really good for that. Plus they help get you into certain books, like, you know, illustration books and different things. And then they do send blasts out to a lot of clients. So it's definitely a good thing to look into, but, you know, you got to find a good agent, you know. That could be a tricky part, you know. And a good agent takes a nice chunk. Like, my agent gets 30%. So that's a lot of money. So sometimes, you know, it's funny, I have this thing back and forth with him. He gets really excited. He's like, you're getting $4,000 for this job. He's like, this is awesome. And I'm like, I'm only getting $2,800. I'm not that excited because I have this, and this to do. If I was getting $4,000 and then we tacked on 30% on top of that, I'd be really happy. But I'm not. So, and I always do this thing, like, I want to say, like, don't tell me how much we're getting. Tell me what I'm getting. I want to hear the percent out of it. So this way, I don't want to do math. I don't like it. So anyway. Yeah. Yeah. It didn't. No.
Pretty sure that's what you said earlier.
No. Before I came here, I was already working as a professional illustrator.
Okay.
I came here because I was stressed out, and I thought that classes would help me become faster. And then I ended up taking, I had life drawing, I had anatomy classes, I had those kind of classes. So I got that job on my own. While I was in a fundamentals class. And I didn't work on that in class, but I worked on the painting that I gave him as a gift later. I worked on that in class.
Nice.
So.
That was in the academy, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Who was your instructor?
Michelle.
Awesome.
Yeah. Yeah. She's pretty awesome. Sorry, I can't. The three W's: whiskey, wine, and water. No, seriously, lots of wine. No. I won't lie. It's really stressful. I never know when the next job's coming, but luckily they come, and I just keep working as hard as I can, and. I'm the kind of person that, even though I know I've got a nice chunk of money saved up, not all the time, but I still am afraid to look at my bank account. Like, I don't like to do that. I don't know why. It's stressful. And even though I know I have enough money in my bank account to pay all my bills, I don't like to pay my bills. Because I'm like, I don't know, I don't want to take that money and put it somewhere else. But I know I have, and it's like I get stressed out about money, like it stresses me out. But, you know, the best way to deal with it for me is just to keep working really hard so that I know that it's like job security. The harder I work, the more that I grow, the more that I challenge myself, the more that I challenge other people by trying to raise the bar as much as I can, the better chances I have of getting the next cover and doing this and doing that. But as far as stress goes, like, I don't know, it's always stressful to some extent. Whiskey. I was 26. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And what was deciding your major, like, for this academy?
I didn't decide a major.
You did not decide a major?
No.
Like, at all, ever?
No. Actually, I was here for about 2 years, and I was wanting to be an illustration major. And then Anthony Kosar was in classes with me, and he was one of my best buddies here. And I saw all the stuff he was doing in illustration class. And I was doing fundamentals, I was doing life drawing, I was doing English classes, math classes, I went here for 2.5 years and I pretty much just did my gen eds and life drawing, fundamentals, and I did an oil painting class. I just did like extra classes. And I was getting to a point where I was supposed to start as an illustration major, but then I saw everything they were doing and I was already kind of doing all that already. And I just realized I just want to draw and paint, and so I was considering switching to a fine art because I just want to draw and paint, and I don't know, it's different for each person, you know, like the illustration classes are great for teaching you all kinds of different illustration techniques, but I already kind of had a lot of that down, and I just wanted to work on my drawing skills, my painting skills, but. I got to a certain point where I was getting really, really busy with my illustration work, and I had a 1.5-year-old baby at the time. I still have her, but she's not a 1.5 anymore. But it was really, really stressful to try to maintain that, plus my professional work that I was trying to do. And so I just made a decision. That's when I went to New York, and I got signed by an agent, and I just decided I just got focused on my artwork. And so that's why I stopped going to school. Huh?
Like when you were doing the best that you could do, the best that you were trying, what were you feeling? Like what emotions were you going to put on in your life feeling at that time? Like your favorite piece, what's your favorite piece?
I don't really like my own art very much, to be honest. I mean, there's a few pieces that, like, you know, the Pope painting, I don't think it's one of my better paintings. Like, I only had a couple days to paint that. But I like it. I think I did a good job. But more than that, the fact that it was a Person of the Year cover, that's like an Academy Award for me. That's how I treat that. And so it feels pretty damn good. But I really look at it like, you know, I don't know really what the next piece is that I'm going to do, but I hope it's going to be my best, you know? And that's, you know, I feel the best when I'm working on something. And when it's finished, I kind of don't care about it anymore. I just can't wait to do something else, you know? So.
During the lecture, you seem to have a lot of knowledge based off your models. Did you interview them prior to modeling them, like a personal one-on-one interview?
What models?
Any models.
It's usually just me. Oh, yeah.
How do you do that?
Camera with a timer. I have lots of outfits. Sometimes I put dresses on, whatever I need. I've never paid a model to model for me. I have friends that say, hey, every once in a while someone poses for me, but mostly it's me. And I have like a mirror I look at, I'm like, ah, you know. I take digital pictures of myself and that kind of stuff, so.
Let's do one more from somebody else. Thank you.
Since you've been progressing again a lot of illustration work, were you able to balance like your personal stuff, personal artwork, and while still balancing?
That's a good question. That's really hard. Like, I don't hardly have any, I have a lot of ambitions for my own work, what I want to do. I have a lot of plans and goals, and a lot of cool things that I'm going to be doing soon, which I'm really excited about. But it's really, really, really difficult to find time for that. Every once in a while I do. I also have two daughters. So to me, I'm spending most of my day drawing and painting and teaching. So as soon as I'm done, I'm gonna hang out with my kids. Like, that's what I'm gonna do. I'd rather do that, you know. And it's kind of weird. Like, I have this new phone now that I can sketch on, which is awesome. And so every once in a while, like, I'll just start drawing and sketching on that. But it's not till after they go to bed at night. If I feel up to it, I'll do other work. But a lot of times I'm just like I'm tired. And now I have a new boxer puppy, and it's like having a child that's on like cocaine or something. So he's like peeing everywhere. It's like a little toddler. So now things are a little bit crazy. And now I'm trying to have him in my studio with me all the time, because I want him to be my little buddy in my studio. And I'm trying to get my work done, and he's just like, let's play. Like, oh. You know, like, so now I have like another kid, I think. But yeah, it's hard. It's hard to balance it, but I don't know. You make it work. You know, if you want it bad enough, you make it happen. You know, there's no, like, one thing I was telling fellow students of mine when I was going here, and I think this is good advice for you guys. If, you know, there is no excuse at all. You should be getting, like, fucking A's across the board. There's no excuse. I was first in class, last to leave. Right? First class, last to leave. Wasn't playing video games. Wasn't in the hallway goofing around. I was, like, you know, trying to do the best work that I could do and push myself. And I mean, I'm here. I mean, I don't know how many of you guys have your parents helping you out. If that's happening, that's pretty cool. That's good for you guys. A lot of students don't. I didn't. I had to do it myself, plus raise a kid. So I was at class, and I didn't miss any school, and it was hardcore. Like, I was like, I want to kick ass. That's what I'm here to do. So, and that's what I try to do, you know. And Anthony Kosar, who's also been very, very successful, same exact thing. That's exactly, and we talked about it in school. And I remember we're talking with fellow classmates, like, they're complaining, like, how do you draw like that? Now stop playing video games, retard. You know, get to work. You know, that's just the way it is. Stop being a goof off and work your butt off. That's the only way it's gonna happen. Because guess what? I personally wish, like, the way that teachers would grade in art schools is how the real world works with art directors and magazines. If you're late, you're out. You're never getting hired again. You know what I'm saying? I think the grading should be like that. But I don't know if you guys like that very much, but that's the way it should be. Because if you want to get magazine work, if your sketches are late, if your finals are late, you're not working for them again. And the art world is very, very small. Art directors, they all know each other. They all go to the same place and get drunk together. They do. Trust me, I know. And the word will spread. It's opposite too. Like, if you kick ass and you're doing amazing, it's gonna spread. People are gonna go, oh dude, you should hire that guy because he did this and this and this. You should hire her because look at what she did here. She handed in 2 days before, you know? That's you gotta do that with your homework assignments too. So anyway.
Here for Jason.